flowers. Bring August.
Bring Mayflowers. Flowers.
Bring Mayflowers.
If you're dyslexic, there you go.
There you go. You know what? We do have to start the show off, though, today, because we have so many tons of email. But I first want to talk about me first. No, I'm sorry. Woody, I'm only joking. We received so many.
What, 50,000,
60,000
hits
a week? A lot of people are complaining about the fact that we're not doing email.
Let me read it to you.
That's one of the email I picked up.
This is from Donna Thompson in Alabama.
Alabama.
All right. Please take some time each and every day to read emails. We learn a lot from other people and their questions. We love the show. My 2-year-old son, Jamie, and 3-year-old daughter, Frankie, both love to watch Home and Family.
F-A-M-B-L-E.
Family. And know that when the theme song plays, it is time. So guess what, kids?
Donna?
Here we go. Everybody, come on. Come on, everybody. It's not email. Come on. It's not email. Come on. It's not email. It's not email. It's not email. Hitting the gifts on the head.
That can't be good.
Put it back, Lawrence.
Okay.
What do you have?
Testosterone cream.
Well, it's been a while since we've talked about that.
From Tanya. I decided to email you about the testosterone cream. I was so delighted today when I finally was able to find your website and found the answer to my problem. Keep up the good work. I am the mother of 5 and 2-year-old, and I've been staying at home for 2 years. I thought I was too young to be having this problem. I am 30. You have given people like myself information that can help with a simple test. And she says, my daughter loves your show. Keep up the good work. Yes, the test is a simple testosterone test. It's a blood test that you take to find out if your testosterone, if you have any testosterone, and then your doctor can prescribe this 2% propionate testosterone cream. And she wanted to know if there were any recipes that will be coming out that the foods that you can eat. And yes, that's my new book called Okay, So I Don't Have a Headache. Okay, and I finished the text and I'm working on the recipes. I'm so excited about the recipes. And the book will be out at the end of this year, or the beginning in January.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Just in time for Christmas.
What?
Yes. Men take this test too?
Men have Viagra now, so you don't have that problem. Yes, men, but men have an overabundance of testosterone, that's why.
Well, maybe some men are worried about that.
Some men are, but I'm sure they could take a test to see if they need testosterone as well. I know Woody did, and he's fine now.
Yes, look, that's why I wear this.
I yell because I care.
That's right.
Here comes one from Mike. Can you please tell me what drug Christina's on? My wife suffers from the exact symptoms that Christina had before she started taking the testosterone replacements. Please include all of her symptoms or direct me to where I can find this information.
Right. What does that mean?
Well,
it means what were your symptoms?
Yeah.
Oh, please.
Well?
There are children in the house this morning.
Lack of desire?
Lack of desire, yes. For about a year. So I used...
For about a year. 12 months.
That was a long time. I did several things. I used the cream, I changed my diet, and I started exercising. I'm back. Remember yesterday when we had that woman I was talking about, she wanted to get pregnant, and she changed the way she ate, and
took the stress
out of her life. And that, well, you know, everybody...
You still have your kids.
Yeah, you still have your kids and a husband and driving and all, you know, and we have to deal with Woody, which
is stressful. Yeah, please. It's only 2 hours a day. What's the next one?
No, that's it.
That's it. I only have two.
You have one more.
How about this one? A woman from New York married 10 different men from that city. Are you with me on this? A woman from New York married 10 different men from that city, yet she did not break any laws. None of these men died, and she never divorced. How is this possible? This comes to us from someone with a lot of free time.
It's not me, is it?
No.
Oh.
The answer? The woman was a justice of the peace.
Oh.
It's your morning riddle.
That's it. Your morning riddle. That's not bad.
We kind of hope for a little bigger response than that.
Are we having morning riddles? Okay. All right.
Those were the emails.
Yeah, those are the emails.
You know who's here?
Everybody.
We met this gentleman at the Jimmy Stewart Marathon. Remember
that? And do you know he ran a mile, I think, in like less than 5 minutes? Four minutes.
Broke all the records. The fastest time out there.
It was unbelievable.
He's from Baywatch. Jose Solano is with us. Hello, Jose.
What was your time for a mile?
4:50.
A 4:50 mile?
4:50, something like that.
And part of a relay.
Yeah, now I'm training for a triathlon.
You ran this morning, didn't you? You ran four miles?
Yeah, I ran 4 miles this morning. Yesterday I swam like 5,000 yards and then rode my bike for about 15, 16 miles.
Well, that's just That's just
little
wrong.
Iron Man, okay.
Yeah, that's what I'm training for.
I know.
Next year's Iron Man.
I know. I understand. He's the Iron Man. I understand that you used to do a little break dancing as well.
Yes.
Yes? Can you give us a demo? A demo?
A demo. Well, I remember in the seventh grade, I had to fit in with all the bullies.
Did you, like, twirl around on the floor?
Yeah.
You did?
Yeah.
Can you do that for us now?
Because we're going to do a lot. We're going to salsa dance later, a little break dance. Sure, we got music for you. Whatever you need, Jose.
Yeah, Mikey, you too.
I'll watch and learn from the master.
Wear the raincoat. It's appropriate.
Right. Give you some traction.
Can we have more loud? We need the music a little louder. We need some audio to the floor, guys. Here we go.
All right, go, baby.
Woo!
Woo!
Whoa!
Oh, man.
Whoa! Woo! You almost got a hit.
Real standpoint.
Wow.
You know, I made that move once, but it was falling down a flight of stairs is how I did that.
Can you show Mikey how to do that?
Yeah, I'll watch the tape tonight and be ready tomorrow.
Yeah. I remember seeing the movies like Break-In and Street Beat, and I remember thinking, I could do that. Me and my brother literally like lived in the garage because my mom wouldn't
Look at that.
Popping and locking.
That's amazing.
You never touched the ground.
Hey, we could use you in the kitchen while we're doing scrambled eggs.
Yeah, you know what that is? That is the power of the hush puppy, actually.
The power of the hush,
the power of the hush puppy. That's exactly what that is.
Well, I was reading the breakdown of Dirty Dancing 2, which I'm going to be up for next week.
Oh.
And it said, must be an accomplished dancer.
There you go.
So I'm like doing the salsa, the breaking, whatever they want to see, I can.
You can bring this tape. You can bring this.
That's right, because we're going to salsa dance later.
Fabulous.
This will help you get the job.
Herbert,
how cool
Rock
is that?
Yeah, all you have to do is mention Home and Family and you're in.
You're in.
That's how much everybody loves this show. The lovely Maita's back, although it's raining like crazy.
Hi.
Are we going outside in this rain today?
Well, I am. I don't know about you. It was Woody's idea that it might be fun and funny to have a fountain outside in the rain.
It sure looks beautiful.
Boring.
Look how pretty. Beautiful.
Yes, isn't it beautiful? Yes. It's loving it out there. The plants are loving it because it's nice and moist. And I'm going to show you how to make this indoor-outdoor fountain, which is so simple. You won't believe how simple it is.
Inexpensively?
Inexpensively.
No, for a lot of money, Mikey. That's what we're about.
It'd be fun to do that whole show where things just cost really too much.
Okay.
Home and Family style.
All right, Maida.
Okay.
And Lawrence is back. You saw him there. Lawrence, what you doing today?
Somewhere.
Summerwear.
Even though it's raining outside, Target has summer fashion that's going to make everyone forget about El Nino. And let me just give El Nino.
Sure.
El Nino.
We get it.
Okay. And let me give you a sneak peek of what we're talking about. Here we have the Von Schert family. And here's a tip. Dress as a family. Solid color tee. And then look at the fun Polynesian-inspired summer shorts that you can wear. And this entire family was dressed for $32.
Very cheap.
And move over here, and here we have Carrie Friedland and her children. We have Sean, Rachel, and Danielle. And look at this. I chose the linen A-line dress as a bathing suit cover-up. And these are the hot colors. For this linen dress, $30. And look at the hot colors for this summer. Turquoise, purple. Real nice colors for the family.
You know what?
And
they can
affordable.
Go outside in the rain and then won't even matter. Look at how it's coming down.
Look at this.
Is this unbelievable?
Do you guys want to go outside and get wet?
Wow, look how it's
okay.
Coming down.
Okay, swimming in the fountain.
Wow.
That is really coming down.
Thank you, Lawrence.
All right, this is a lot of fun. This morning I was so busy doing this. It's Fantasy Baker Cliff Simon. He's here. And he makes the most wonderful fantasy cakes.
Yeah.
So.
Hiya, Cliff.
Thank you. Hey.
Where's the cake that we're
there on the end?
Yeah, is there a cake that we're looking at? There it is.
Oh, my
Look
gosh.
At this. Oh, my gosh, is that beautiful. How long did it take you to make that?
It took weeks.
Weeks.
It was doing a lot of stuff beforehand, and then the final 2 or 3 days.
Oh, man.
Oh, that is so exciting. And, of course, we're going to do it here for $5 and in 10 minutes, right?
Less than $5, yeah.
That is so beautiful. Is that like is that a Fabergé egg?
Fabergé egg, yeah. Fashioned after a real one that Malcolm Forbes had.
Was this commissioned by someone for you?
This was not, but Mr. Forbes saw this, and then I did some stuff for him after.
Could you eat that? Did somebody eat that cake?
You could eat it. I ate the angels, yeah.
But you don't want it.
I just stuck the angel in my mouth and ate it.
You don't want anybody to eat that.
I would freeze it and keep it forever.
No, go get Entenmann's and then keep that in your house.
Yeah. You couldn't eat.
Well, later in the show, Cliff is going to show us how to make a special cake, and he made one for Home and Family. All right.
Which you broke the H on.
I broke the H.
but we're going to make another H. Okay.
There are more letters, more times. Right. Also joining us is...
Now, are we really going to do this? John Harbutt is here, who invented a new type of volleyball. And, John, what is it?
Night Spiker is volleyball played at night under black lights. These black lights will illuminate the whole court at night, and yes, it can be played in the rain. It's water resistant.
Oh, fun.
Okay, I'll tell you more about it later.
Well, fun.
There you go.
Who's going to go out there and do it?
They're out there playing now.
In the rain.
How come it looks like it's not raining and it's pouring?
Does it just stop the
I'm not going out there.
That's great.
Oh, nice shot of the sky. Like,
very nice.
Really see.
Nice definition there.
Yeah.
All right.
Get a nice tight shot on that one raindrop. Can you do that?
Yeah. It is coming down, but it'll be fun to watch you play, Mikey.
Yeah, I'll be out there.
Yeah.
That really sounds fun, though, because you
wouldn't
know what
that
it
be
is.
Great?
John, where's John? Is he out there?
He's outside.
Okay. They play it at night.
Yeah.
And you can play, I mean, that would be
a
fun.
A nice beach in
that
the Bahamas.
That would really be a lot of fun.
Love it.
Yeah.
All right.
Also with this is author Deborah Foreman, who wrote Every Parent's Guide to the Law.
Yes.
Hello, Deborah.
Hello.
Deborah's the one we hit earlier with the beach ball. How are you?
Yeah, I'm okay. I feel like a beach ball. 9 months pregnant. But
how many months are you?
Doing about a week.
Wow. Really? You look great.
Thank you.
Wow.
So you're here to get us caught up on the law, specifically the Family and Medical Leave Act?
Well, that's a federal law that applies nationwide, and it gives employees of companies that have at least 50 employees a right to 12 weeks of unpaid family leave to take care of themselves or a child after the birth of a child or adoption, or if you have a seriously or chronically ill child.
Mm-hmm. So we'll get into the law and what it means and what to look out for.
Fathers as well?
It does.
Okay.
Fathers and mothers.
Oh, okay, very good. Yeah. All right.
Welcome to the show.
Nice to have you.
Thank you.
Right.
Boy, if you let us know how you feel, if at some point during the show you have to go.
I know.
You know what? It'd be great if we could actually deliver a baby.
Can
right
you have the baby now? It'd help us a little bit.
Yeah, well, I think I'd rather wait.
That's right.
Yeah, are you?
EMT certified.
There you go.
Breakdancer, doctor. There you go.
I was a medic.
TV reality.
He was a medic. You see
you
what
do
I'm
the
saying?
Math, as
there you
say, right?
go.
All right.
Want a foxtrot or do you want to have the baby? He can do it all.
And look what we're cooking today. Look at what we're cooking. It's flank steak with
like
honey chipotle glaze. And Jamie, look at that. Isn't that delicious?
Jamie's
outside in the rain.
Hi. This is funny, Woody. Very funny.
Jamie,
barbecuing with an umbrella.
And I have to dump the water from my platter to put the steak out.
Oh, my gosh.
What a trooper.
Oh, my gosh. I think maybe we ought to rinse.
Look
oh,
at
how
that.
Good
oh,
does that look?
That's nice.
Worth
with
it.
The
worth the rain.
Beautiful.
Nice. That's so people know this is a real house.
Absolutely.
You know, that's all it is.
Okay. Thanks,
that's
Jamie.
All I'm trying to
like
do.
They don't know this is a real house?
Well, you know, I don't know. Well, a lot of people don't.
All right, wait, this is a real house.
Yeah.
And
with real guests.
Real bathrooms and a toilet that flushes and TV, everything.
Wow. We'll fill in the blanks from here.
Okay.
Jose Solano from Baywatch is next. We'll take a break. Be right back.
Yay. Tram audience from Universal Studios. Hi, guys.
Hi, audience. How you doing? Good to see you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. All right, our next guest has been called Best Chest in the West. Okay, and you can find him weekly on the beaches of Baywatch. Let's take a look.
Manny, turn around. I want to get your picture.
Mom, what are you doing here? I thought you have to work.
Well, I took the day off. I wanted to see my son at his job. That's my son, the lifeguard.
Mom, stop that.
Well, can't a mother be proud of her son? Now, come on, give me a smile and hold over that buoy thing over there.
Mom, that's not a buoy thing. It's a rescue can.
Oh, you're so handsome.
Say hi to Jose Solano. And that was Vicky Carr. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm surprised she didn't
sing.
The legend,
please
Vicky
be
Carr.
Him.
You know, you mentioned something in the open about breakdancing and how it kept the bullies away. Did you? Was it more of a street survival?
It was, well, for me, it was just a way to fit in with all the people that I couldn't connect with. You know, I wore braces. I had to carry my books to school because my dad wouldn't give me a backpack. Oh. You know, so it was like, you know, he raised me with a lot of discipline. Yeah. And at school, it was like I had to deal with all like the cholos, some of the wannabe cholos.
Yeah.
And for me, it was just a way to kind of display, you know, my way of connecting with them.
Did you get beat up?
No. I ran.
He's a runner.
I'm a runner.
Yeah.
Where'd you go to school?
In Northern California, Daly City. It's a little town. Actually, it's inside Colma, which is where a lot of the cemeteries are at. So, you know, people are dying to get in.
Where's our rim shot? Jose's working on that. Thank you. You know, he also mentioned something that the breakdancing sort of petered out when kids start breaking their neck. Is that right?
Yeah, I remember, movies like Breaking, yeah. Street Beat. I wanted to audition for some of those movies.
Sure.
But I didn't know anything about what an agent was or manager was.
Did you always want to be an actor from the time?
I always wanted to be a performer. Mm-hmm. In athletics and soccer and track and field and cross country.
You figure that maybe get you there, take that route to athletics?
Yeah, well, you know, the people, crowds would come in to watch, you know, all the runners.
Like the yeah. roar of the crowd yeah. and the smell of the grease
yeah.
paint. All
right. That's why I identify with theater uh-huh. and working on a sitcom like Caroline in the City, which is airing soon, and being in front of cameras and people and like Baywatch.
Doesn't faze you now, right?
No. I just focus on the character and I try to let the craft that I've been learning kind of take care sure. of itself.
It's an interesting start. Did you know that you didn't actually send your pictures out to get discovered? Was it a friend that sent your pictures to, it a modeling agency?
No, I was achieving my associate's degree in San Francisco, and a friend of mine tapped me on the shoulder. She says, hey, listen, there's this contest for this magazine.
Oh, what is that?
Oh, my God.
Is that you?
Yeah.
Oh, my God, you are so
Look at that cake.
How old were you? Look at that.
I was, 8, 9 years old.
Look at that suit. It's so cute.
They sent your pictures where?
They sent them to YM Magazine. Actually, this was the picture they sent. To YM Magazine, they were having this contest called the Young and Modern Man of the Year contest. And I ended up winning the contest, and I was saving my money at Structure. I was working as a manager there.
A clothing store
in San Jose, California. And when they saw the producer saw the pictures that were featured in the magazine, they called me in for an audition.
For Baywatch?
Yeah, and I went up to my district manager, my boss, and I said, listen, I need the day off tomorrow morning because I have to go to L.A. and audition for the show. She's like, I'm sorry, I can't give you the day off because I have a mandatory manager's meeting and you have to open the store in the morning.
Oh.
So right then and there, it was like a test, you know, and I prayed. I consulted with my family, and they said, listen, follow your heart. What is your heart? What does your conscience tell you? And it told me to quit.
Did you call your regional manager back and say, hello?
The first thing I did after I landed the job, and when our pictures came in, you know, that said Manny Gutierrez on Baywatch, I signed an autographed picture, sent it to her. Thank you for believing in me.
Wow. And she's still selling pants, and you're on the cover of whatever. Yeah, yeah. But nothing wrong with selling pants, by the way. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah. It's amazing. And that's when I talk to kids, different organizations, Para Los Niños, Camp Baywatch, whatever, the inner cities. I always tell them, listen, you can do what you want to do in life. All you have to do is believe in yourself and go for your dreams. I did it. You can do it. Anybody can do it. You just have to follow your heart.
Yeah.
You have to have dreams, goals, and aspirations, and go for it.
Sure.
Now, earlier today, you showed us how to break dance, and I understand that you also do salsa dancing?
I love salsa.
All right. So when did you start doing that?
I remember my parents, they used to invite musicians over to the house, and they used to have these, you know, these, like, get-togethers where they play the congas and the whole deal. And I remember my mom used to always get me out, and she used to teach me how to dance.
I bet you had great food too after
that. Oh, great.
God, I love that.
My parents are from Nicaragua.
Oh, God.
So, nacatamales and bajo, and just very authentic food, rich in flavor.
Do you cook?
Will you
come back and cook something authentic?
I would love to.
Yeah, that would be
Maybe
great.
I'll bring my mom.
Bring your mom! Let's do that.
She makes the best tamales ever.
Bring your mom to do that.
I have about three or four in the freezer that I've had for the last 6 months, and I always kind of take them out little by little on special occasions when I miss her a lot. You know, I kind of boil it up.
And bring the conga.
Yeah.
And bring the lady from Structure.
Yeah, well,
definitely.
Yeah,
right.
Take it back. We're going to come back. We're going to do some salsa dancing with Jose from Baywatch.
What are you doing? Washing the floor?
Trying to get my boy out of prison.
We're back with Jose Solano from Baywatch. And joining us are salsa dance instructors Albert Torres and Laura Canelius.
Welcome to the show.
Nice
good to see you.
Thank you.
So, salsa dances are popular again, yes?
Yes, it's become really popular. I think it's because it's so simple and it's like having safe sex. You know, it's just, it's so passionate. And
yes, can I wear that outfit?
Look, yeah. Sure.
Okay,
sure.
Actually, I need one of those.
Just we asked somebody on the break here if they liked salsa dancing and he said what?
Yes?
He eats it.
Yeah.
He eats it. All right. Can you do a little salsa? We'll watch and learn from the masters, and then we'll you'll take us through it step by step.
We'd love to. Sure. We'd love to.
Watch the pros. Here we go. Show us the basic
steps. You want us to show them?
Show us the basic steps. First, show us.
Laura. And people from the Home and Family Tram audience, try to.
We're going to show you how simple these steps are.
Okay, show us.
Why don't you show us first and then you can.
Okay.
We're going to start with our left foot forward.
Let's watch first.
And we're going to do like what's called a quick, quick, slow. We're going to go quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow. Quick, quick, slow. If you're at home, you can do it also. And quick, quick, slow. Oh, they're great. And quick, quick, slow, and quick. Now we're going to do the side. Quick, quick, slow. Quick, quick, slow. Quick, quick, slow. Quick, quick. What do you think? How are they doing? How are they doing? Oh, we got salsa dancers here, huh? Now what we're going to do is we're going to do a little crossover. We're going to go back into forward. We're going to do quick, quick, slow. Quick, quick, slow. Quick, quick, slow. And at this point, we're going to cross over to the right and to the left. And quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow. And on the next one, I'd like to see you do a whole turn. Here we go. Yeah. Whoops, and quick, quick, slow. So we'll do it again. We'll do it slow.
Okay.
We'll go forward. We'll go quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow. One more time now. Cross over. Quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow. Turn around all the way. There we go. And here. Okay, we're going to try it one more time?
Yeah, one more time.
Okay, what we want to do is we're going to do it one more time, and then we're going to partner up.
All right.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, we can do it with some music.
Yeah.
Okay, a little music on this one. And quick, quick, slow. 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 Here goes the turn. And there we go. There. One more time, and we turn. All the way. There we go. Now what we're going to do is we're going to partner up. How about a hand?
Okay.
He grabbed
it.
I'm going to grab my either here.
Mike's no gonna idea do what we're doing.
And we're going to have both hands. We're going to take both hands.
Yes.
And we're going to go quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow. And now we're going to cross over.
We cross.
At this point, Mike.
Yeah.
There you go.
Rock forward.
There you go.
Rock forward.
There you go.
Rock forward.
Now the next one, we're going to let her go. And she's going to go turn. And we're turning. And here we are again.
When are you going to turn?
Quick, quick, slow.
But I don't
quick,
know.
Quick,
yes,
slow.
Yes, you do. You
quick.
Do.
Okay.
Okay. And then,
let's try it again. Let's try it again.
All right.
He's Mr. Dirty Dancing himself.
Yeah.
I mean, I saw his break dancing.
And then you rock back for the right.
Okay, here we go.
Okay.
Five, six, seven, and quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow.
Shorter
quick,
steps.
Quick, slow, quick, quick, slow. And here we go, crossover. And once.
That's it.
Twice. One.
And turn.
Now this one we turn.
One more time.
Turn.
There you go. Okay. Great.
How about one last little thing?
Yeah.
What?
Let's see if they can do this. Let's put our hands out. Okay, face the camera. And go for it. There you go. Looking good.
Albert Torres looking good.
We got
salsa
dancers
here. Jose Solano on Baywatch. We'll do a little dance and take a break. We'll be right back. Fire it up, guys. Okay. There we are. dancing that little salsa. If you like salsa, you're going to love barbecue. If you love beef, you're going to love what we make. It's called flank steak. Just follow along. Honey glazed chipotle sauce surprise. Glazed.
Yum. I can't wait to do the tamales. I can't wait to do that.
Do you like to cook, Jose, a little bit?
I love to cook. This is like at home.
He is a man of great passion.
Jose Solano from Baywatch is with us.
Yeah.
What do we got?
Okay, here we go. We're going to marinate the steak. This is a flank steak. This is what it looks like. Actually, it's a very inexpensive cut of meat. Yeah. But if you marinate it, it becomes nice and tender. So we're very lean. And what we're going to do is we just use, for the marinade, we're going to whisk together 3 tablespoons of olive oil. There we go. And 3 tablespoons of lime juice, fresh lime. Please, go ahead, you can mix it right up there. Okay. 1 chopped garlic clove. You could put 2.
How's my buddy Hasselhoff over there?
He's great.
You still doing that?
Yeah.
You still do that
too? He's awesome.
Sure, yeah.
Sometimes once in a while I catch him looking into his watch saying, Kit, where are you?
Kit.
David, wrong show.
Does he ever let his stomach out or does he always hold it in? What's up with that? Does he ever let his stomach out or does he always hold it in?
He's pretty good in shape.
Good answer. Yeah.
He's really toying with you. He's very much in shape. You know?
All right, to that we're going to add 1 teaspoon of ground cumin and we're going to add the steak. Here it is.
Way to sell it.
There you go. Just pop it in there like that, and you'll marinate it for a couple of hours. Overnight, if you like.
Right?
Absolutely. Now, to make the glaze, what you're going to do is, Mike, you can do this.
Sure.
You combine 2 tablespoons of honey. You know how to get that out of there if it's, like, really hot? You stick your spoon in hot water or in some boiling water, and then it'll just come right out of there. Just take
the hot spoon
and it comes right out. All right, 1 tablespoon of Dijon mustard. Or you could use grainy mustard if you like, or regular Dijon mustard. Mm-hmm. And 1 tablespoon of hoisin sauce. You can get that in the Oriental section. Hoisin.
Nice lady, hoi.
Sam Lee? Okay, no, Kim Lee. 1 tablespoon of lime juice again, and 1 chopped garlic clove. And to that, we're going to add 2 teaspoons of minced chipotle chiles, reconstituted and chopped.
Where do you get these?
Where do we get these, Jamie?
They come dried, and they're selling them in the spice section now of every supermarket. They come in like a little plastic bag, and you need to put them in boiling water for about 30 minutes till they
plump up,
absorb all the liquid. Right.
That's why we say it's delicious. Reconstituted. Now, we're going to drain the marinade from the steak, like that.
Save the liquid too.
Well, can't. Yeah. All right, there you go. Now wait a minute. What did you say?
Save the liquid that you reconstitute the mushrooms in. Because
I thought you meant
flavor.
The glaze
no,
to put that
all
in
the flavor from
stock.
The mushrooms.
Yeah.
And then use it in a soup or a stock. It's delicious.
Now we're going to brush the steak with the glaze right here. Ta-da. And then we
You brush on both sides?
Yes, you'll brush it on both sides. And then you'll cook it on the grill as Jamie...
Oh, the meat. I'm sorry.
All right, there you go. And then when it's finished, it comes out nice and glazed and beautiful like that, and you slice it very thin. You could serve it on great French bread or serve it up with some great potatoes.
Wow.
Nice salad. Would you like to taste some?
Or with tortillas.
Mm-hmm. Oh, tortillas.
Yeah, fajitas.
Yes, fajitas. Mikey, what is our chicken tip today?
Hey, Kip's, Marquetta of Ohio. And April of New York. We have 2 tips. Okay, Marquetta. Hello, Marquetta.
Hi.
How are you? Are you in Ohio?
In Portsmouth, Ohio.
Yeah, well, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
What's your kitchen tip?
To open a jar.
Yep.
Barbecue style.
You just take the end of the spoon up under the lid.
Yeah.
And press down.
And press down, okay.
On the spoon.
Yeah. And then what happens?
It'll come open.
What comes open?
The jar, the lid comes off.
What? Well, it loosens it, but it doesn't pop off, right?
Right.
Oh, look at that. It did. So if you have trouble twisting it off, this will make it easier.
Not everybody has a big hefty man around the house or a big strong woman that can open. I can't open every jar, so it sort of gives you leverage. Right.
That's great, Marquetta. Now, April is also on the phone with a kitchen tip. April, it along the same lines. What happens if you bend the spoon?
Well, Mike, you have to get another spoon.
Get another spoon. All right. That's it. It's our first 2 kitchen tip.
They came in at the same time, at the same day, and so we felt it only fair to give 2 tips.
Well, how about both of you then picking up the Samsung 1.5 cubic inch microwave oven valued at $279? What do you think of that?
Great.
Now, Jose, how do you like the
steak?
Thank
you for the tips.
Yes, thank you for the tips.
You know what, Christina?
What?
We don't have any. We tried to find some tortillas.
Tortillas.
Everybody's ripping the kitchen apart back there.
You have any. I always keep tortillas in my refrigerator.
When I come with my mom, we'll bring some tortillas.
Please.
Handmade.
Yes.
Handmade.
And don't forget the congas, and we'll have a big celebration.
Absolutely.
That's
fun. Let's great. Sauce.
Isn't that good?
Great.
The mariachi's everything. Let's have a party.
Yeah.
All right. A theme party.
We'll take a break. We'll come back. What every parent needs to know about the law. We'll take a break. Be right back.
Yeah.
Back. Hey, the legal questions that face parents today are limitless, such as, here's a question, are single mothers vulnerable to pregnancy discrimination? How about this one? What do you do if your teen's arrested? Or, what's the best way to check out your nanny? From across the street. I'm sorry. Hey, I'm sorry. It just came to me. These and other questions are answered in Deborah L. Foreman's new book, Every Parent's Guide to the Law. She's here today to provide some sensible explanations to some complicated questions.
Yeah,
forgive the joke
there.
Welcome.
But he had to go for the comedy.
Okay.
All right. So, you are 9 months pregnant?
Yes.
Is your first baby?
It is.
Okay. Yeah. So, what are some of the issues that are going to face parents today, and what are some of the things that you're concerned about?
Well, there are a lot of legal issues facing parents across the country. Of course, all the issues surrounding divorce are very hot topics today, but also child care issues, that's been in the news a lot lately, and this parental liability for teenagers.
Yeah, talk about that. How responsible is a parent for a child messing up and doing something?
Well, more than they probably would like to be.
Yeah?
There are two ways a parent could be responsible under the law. The first way is that they may be responsible for monetary damages. They could be sued. If your child goes out and does something willful or malicious or intentional that injures somebody else or damages their property, you could be responsible.
What about that famous case that just last week where the verdict was he wasn't sent to jail, but he had a community service, and he wasn't drunk, but he drove the car, and a couple of kids were injured, and one was, you know which one I'm talking about, and one was killed. And they said they're going back to sue the parents and the family now
when you're talking about teen driving, that's an area that there's a lot of potential parental liability. Even when you sign your child's application for the driver's license, you usually assume legal responsibility there. If you lend your child your car, that can make you liable if they're negligent. And understand that these kind of laws I'm talking about mean that you're responsible even if you've done nothing wrong.
Mm-hmm. But what do you do if you have a child who just does not listen and totally rebels, and there's nothing you can do short of killing them, and they go out and they do something and they just don't listen? Why are you still liable?
Well, you have to understand the law is trying to balance a couple of policies here. On the one hand, you're right, it seems a little unfair to make you responsible, but on the other hand, the law wants to encourage you to do as much as you can to control your child, and also they want to provide some compensation for people who are injured.
Sure.
Most children don't have any money, so who are they going to go after? They're going to go after the parents.
Talk about parental responsibility ordinances.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this has been a pretty popular trend across the country. A number of cities have enacted them, and what they do is they actually impose criminal liability on parents who fail to reasonably control their children.
So it's different from state to state or city to city?
It's very different from city to city, actually.
Give us an example.
Well, there was there's an ordinance in a town in Michigan, and a teenager had committed several burglaries, had a gun sitting on his night table, drank in the home. His parents knew about all those things.
Mm-hmm.
He went out and committed the next burglary. Next thing you know, they're slapped with charges under this parental responsibility ordinance.
How do you know what they tried to do to deter this child from doing all those things? I mean, maybe they tried and there's nothing they can do to make this kid stop. Right.
Well, in most cases, the law is going to ask the parents to do no more than be reasonable, to try to control and understand that if it's really outside of their ability, they won't be responsible. But these laws are controversial.
Have they been charged? I mean, do they do time and such?
I haven't heard of any actually going to jail, but they have paid fines.
A lot of money is involved. It could really break a home. It could break you financially.
So if you know that your child has a gun, do you have to attempt to take that gun away? Or I mean,
what do the parents do to protect themselves?
I'd call the police.
You have to...
I'd be on the phone so fast.
You have to be concerned for your own safety, of course.
Well, sure.
Yeah, I think that it would be a good first step to say there aren't going to be any guns in the house and make sure that the child gets rid of it.
Right.
I think that's why it's so important to have communication with, you know, with your children. And now I know why I didn't drive until I was 18.
Why? Because
looking out for you. They didn't want to take the responsibility.
That's right. Right. No, I didn't. I didn't have my license until I was 18.
So what are parents do in an extreme case? I mean, what should they do?
Well, I wouldn't say they should do it. This has got to be an individual family decision. But it is an option to petition the court to have your child declared what's called a status offender. Different states have different names for it. You might be called a minor in need of supervision. But you have to understand that at that point, the child may be sent to an out-of-home placement, a group home, or foster care. And once you get the state involved in your lives, it's like a runaway train. You're not going to be able to control what happens.
You're not going to be able to get this child back if you...
You may not be able to. You need to really think long and hard before you take that step.
All right, we have to take a break. When we come back, we're going to find out about legal issues surrounding child care.
Take a break. Take a break. Back, we're with Deborah L. Foreman. We're talking about her new book, Every Parent's Guide to the Law, and you talk about child care issues in your book.
Yeah, that's a really hot topic today. You know, there was the nanny trial and a lot of stuff about daycare these days, and a lot of legal issues parents should
be
aware of.
What kind of legal issues should we be aware of?
Well, first of all, they're going to vary depending on what kind of child care you have. If you have someone come into your home, for example, you're going to have legal issues about your tax liability for the person.
Well, let's start at the top. What do you look for when you're hiring a caregiver?
Well, I think the first thing that people are going to look for is someone who is going to meet their child's needs, be caring, nurturing, responsible, provide stimulation for the child. And of course, you know, provide a safe environment for the child.
Excuse me, everybody gives a good interview, okay?
Yeah.
So, what are...
Everybody checks references. Okay, that's going to be my first comment. You've got to really check those references. Ask probing questions. If you use an agency, don't assume that the agency is screening those applicants. Ask them about their screening procedures. Demand to see the file. It should have a DMV report. It should have a criminal background check in it. It should have an employment history.
Should you do your own criminal background check as well, rather than just leaving it up to an agency to say, we've done it, everything is fine?
Well, I think if they show you the report, you can probably feel pretty confident about it. But otherwise, it's not a bad idea. Mm-hmm. Some states now let you go do that directly. I think Colorado is one. You can go into the public library.
How do you do that?
How do you do what?
Background check.
Probably you've got to hire somebody to help
like
you do
detective?
It.
Like a detective?
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, okay. And it doesn't necessarily have to be that expensive. And, you know, this is a big investment.
By law, should you tell them that you're doing that, the caregiver? Saying, I'm going to run a check on you? Or is it okay to do it without telling them you're going to run a check on them?
Yeah, well, I can't speak to the law in every state. I think, you know, as a matter of policy, it's probably a good idea just to tell them, you know, this is part of, you know, the interview process. But I don't think it's required.
Right. Something wrong, they're going to disappear fast.
Right.
Okay, you mentioned the tax credit. Define the tax credit versus a deduction.
There are a couple of issues here besides, there's the tax liability issues, which I think most people are a little concerned about these days, which is, what do you have to pay? You're talking about the tax credit. That's what the IRS gives to you.
What you get back.
Right.
But discuss both.
Yeah, okay, the tax credit. There is a limited tax credit, a percentage of your income that you can have applied, you know, toward your tax bill.
So if you hire a caregiver, there's a certain number that the IRS will let you
And it's graduated based on your income, and at some point it phases out. I mean, this type of thing, you can contact the IRS, and they will send you the booklet and the forms, talk to your accountant, talk to a lawyer about these issues, because they change all the time.
Well, if you're paying your caregiver, and then they don't pay their taxes, are you responsible for their taxes?
No, you're not responsible for them paying their income tax. You do have to give them a W-2 form, but you don't have to withhold their income taxes for them. The taxes that you need to check into are Social Security, Medicare, and unemployment. Depending on how much your nanny works for you, you may be responsible for those. Again, good idea. You can call the IRS directly. You know, the book has the names and addresses and the forms and all that, you know, where you get them. But also, you know, talk to your accountant, talk to a lawyer if, you know, there's any question about what your obligation is.
Okay.
So is there anything that you can do to protect yourself tax-wise from being liable for any of the taxes?
Well, if the law applies to you, it applies to you, and you've got to pay up.
So what steps do you need to take to ensure the character of your caregiver, besides just going to the... is there any other things that we can do to make sure that the caregiver that we have is safe for our home?
Well, you know, we talked about the references and background checks. You want to drop in unannounced.
Okay.
This is particularly an issue now with daycare centers.
Right.
But I think it applies across the board. You want to be sure that you know what's going on when you're not around.
How about those videotape things that you do? You know, where they hide those things in appliances?
Yeah, that's kind of controversial. Mm-hmm. Legally, again, it could vary by state, so you might want to consult with a lawyer about that, too. But there is precedent, absolutely, for taping employees in the workplace. Hmm.
Okay, but either way, whether you bring someone into your house or whether you go to a daycare center, check it out on both ends.
Absolutely.
Check the person or check the center as you go there.
Lots of good advice in here.
Yeah. The book is called Every Parent's Guide to the Law. It's available at every bookstore nationwide. Right. Thanks, Deborah, and congratulations.
Thank you.
Let us know.
When we come back, Fantasy Baker Cook Simon will be here. We're going to bake a cake.
Simon. July shower here, coming to you live from the studios, and a man just walking across the yard. We got a shot of him, too. Our next guest could be described as the Picasso of cakes. Take a look at that. Beautiful. Catering to clients with a taste for the unusual. How about that? Look at that. He has created everything from a traditional wedding cake. That looks more than traditional, doesn't it? And a Fabergé replica. Look at that. Behind each of his creations is a wonderful story. Please welcome Cliff Simon. Hi, Cliff.
Hey, how you doing? Hey, Michael. Hey, Christina.
Do you live here in L.A.?
No, I live in Santa Fe.
Oh, but we could order cakes from you and you ship them up?
Yeah, I mail them. People fly me in sometimes.
Well, do you have a brochure? Do they just, like, if I wanted to have a cake made like the centerpiece, can you do that?
It's possible. I would talk to you. I'd say, this could look cool if you do this, or don't try that. It's not going to be good.
Right.
Go on.
Go ahead.
I just steer people in the direction that I think will be the best cake.
How does it start with you? Yeah. Did you have a little Easy Bake Oven as a kid? And then right? Remember those, Kenner? Who didn't like that? I liked that, and then I took the Hot Wheels car and went right over the cake.
I wanted one. They never got me one. My background is a set designer, and I just love eating chocolate. And in the 70s, I just started baking cakes. I got a Julia Child cookbook, and I bake cakes, and I couldn't eat them all. I would bring one into work every day, and then it went on from there. I just wanted to make them look great.
Sure.
Yeah.
But your cakes resemble works of art and sculptures, and you can eat it all.
Yeah.
It's all edible. It seems a shame to eat these beautiful pieces of artwork.
Yeah, it's just cake. It's
it's just
him. It's art.
I tell people that it's just a cake. I get all my pleasure out of doing it, and once I'm done doing it, it's over.
Oh.
So I don't care if they eat it.
Right.
Oh gosh! But now your first celebrity was Diana Ross.
Yeah.
Okay. So how did she find out about you? What'd you make for her?
I had done a lot of stuff for her at Radio City when she was appearing there, and then when she was going to get married, I was in San Francisco then, and she called me and said she wanted a wedding cake for her wedding in Switzerland. And her husband had climbed Mount Everest, and she wanted a spiral cake.
Wow.
Actually, I was meeting with her in Los Angeles at Bob Mackie's studio, and we were thinking of a mountain shape, and Bob Mackie took my pencil and he said, how about this? And he drew, like, the Tower of Babel.
Wow.
Well, how did you ship it over to Switzerland?
No, they flew me there.
They flew you there with the cake?
No.
Made the cake.
Oh, you made the cake.
They flew me there to bake, but it was frightening. The Swiss hated me.
Why?
They hated me, because I was an American.
Right,
the Swiss
coming
did things
in
better than everybody else. Sure. And I was very intimidated.
Get over it.
I come from this background where I think everybody's looking at me, so I was very intimidated. And when I was making the cake, I thought I would just do like cake filling, and when it was 4 feet high, sculpt it out.
Right.
But I forgot about gravity. And when it was eight inches high, all the filling started oozing out of the side.
Yeah.
And the head chef is standing in the corner, like just like smiling at me.
And American kind of thing.
Yeah, really. And I wrapped the whole cake in wax paper. I stapled it together, and I rolled it into the walk-in. And I'm surrounded by Cornish game hens all around me. And I just got down on my knees and I started crying because this big star had flown me to Europe.
Oh,
oh no!
But then I prayed. And I prayed, and a miracle happened. I got inspiration.
Yeah.
And what did God say to you?
God said, let there be light. No, I asked the carpenter of the hotel to cut out a circle of plywood, and then we cut a spiral into it. And if you imagine doing that with a piece of paper, cutting a piece of paper in a spiral, if you lift it,
pull it up.
It's like the Tower of Babel, and we gave it structure, and we faced it, and I coated the whole thing with chocolate. And then I put cake on the runway, actually, going around. But more things happened, but I lived.
You did some cakes for Malcolm Forbes as well. Go ahead and show these. And
into Fabergé eggs, Malcolm Forbes. Big time.
Yeah, so he saw the one. Yeah. This is not Malcolm Forbes.
Go to the next
one.
What
is this?
Well, this is cool. This one, this Jewish woman on Long Island who had a lot of money saw the Diana Ross cake, and she wanted a cake like it, only bigger. Like, my people like things bigger. Yeah. So it was a 7-foot-high cake, and there were scenes of her life painted on slabs of chocolate that went around the cake. That's her, you know, her photo.
This is a little history of, a little photo album.
Yes. The only thing with that cake, it had to be split down the center the night before the event because it couldn't fit through the doors where we made it.
Oh, my gosh.
Nor could it fit through the doors of where it was going to be. So we had a whole structure built that actually could be bolted together. It was fun.
Give me
it
some idea of what kind of money we're talking, from the most expensive to the least
for
expensive.
For you, $14.95.
Not for me.
What was the most expensive cake you ever made? Idea.
This one was pretty expensive. This wound up being around $15,000 or $16,000.
Wow. What?
That's what makes him an artist.
And it's just a cake.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Show the Malcolm Forbes cake. Do we have them?
Yeah, and how much did this Fabergé... You could buy a Fabergé egg for what you... No, not really.
Actually, this one I did as a proposal when he had his 70th birthday in Morocco, but he thought it was too expensive. It was $90. But
the egg was... How big was it?
It was this big, and he kept it. I was told that they keep proposal cakes and not to take it with me. And the next week in People magazine, there's a picture of Elizabeth Taylor and my cake, and Malcolm Forbes had flown it to California to give to her.
That
cake?
And they asked
him how much it was, and he said it's almost as much as the real thing. Oh. And I was thinking Fabergé eggs are 1.2 million, maybe.
Right.
And this cake was what?
This was nothing. He took it for nothing.
Look at that.
But then, a few months later, he commissioned me to make this, and this one was actually about 3 feet high, and it was on legs, and he wanted me to deliver it from New York to San Diego. So he got a seat on the plane for me and a seat for the cake.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, that's fabulous. Why didn't he just send you his plane?
That would have been good.
Yeah.
No, but the airlines were nuts. They wouldn't let me keep the cake on the seat. And I said, but he paid for the seat.
Yeah.
And I got out seatbelt extenders, and they tried to make it fit. And the plane was held up for 15 minutes. 15
I
minutes for
it.
A cake.
Oh, God.
Until finally we went.
And so did the cake travel on in the seat?
Well, yeah.
I love it. Yeah. Wow. I love it. I understand that you made a special cake for home and family. Is this true?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
I slaved on this cake.
Do we have it here?
Yeah, bring it in.
Where is it? I'm so...
Such a work of art.
God. What do you see?
Of art. Wow. Look at this.
Oh, look.
It is so beautiful.
Now, you have to know that we're gonna continue the decoration. There are letters missing. This show is not called Home and Anal.
Anal.
Home and Anal.
Anal. Home and Anal.
Yes.
Anal.
It's all edible, though, right?
Look,
it's all fondant.
Everything's edible. This is all sugar, all fondant.
Oh, my God.
I don't want a
detail. So,
look at the detail on the side here. Look at this.
So this is all sugar. This is sunny side up eggs, tomato bisque soup, and matzo ball soup.
Matzo ball soup and tea.
And what's in it? What kind of cake is it?
It's a butter sponge cake with a raspberry filling and chocolate frosting.
There is an awful lot of work into this. Look at the detail.
Tremendous.
Look at all the dishes.
Now, how long would this take to make, or did it?
It took hours. Like, last night, my hotel room, actually, I was making all of the sugar stuff, which means you could make it anywhere you want.
This is obviously a passion for you to do all these little details.
Pastry chef extraordinaire.
Well, do we
your work speaks
can
for
we take
yourself.
A picture of this before we... I don't want to cut
you
it.
You can't cut it.
No.
Yeah, you got to cut it. It's just a cake.
He's got the right attitude. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Do we have a camera? Can we get a... I'll be right back. We have to get a picture.
Yeah. More with Cliff on how to make these cakes at home. How's that? You like that?
So good.
That's, some of Cliff's work here. This is the cake he made last night in his hotel room. That's the detail. I haven't bought stemware that looked like nice.
Uh-uh. It's fabulous.
Great work. Are you do you paint as well? Are you an artist beyond?
Yeah. I paint. I used to be a set designer.
Yeah.
So.
Well. All right. So we are going to show you how to make some great additions to your cake and bring it to a new level. Something called fondant art. Is that what I'm holding? Is fondant?
You're holding fondant and fondant.
Fondant. Is what?
From basically sugar and water. I don't make it. I just don't have time. But you could buy it in all cake decorating stores. It works like clay, and it's cool.
And it's edible.
Really? It's perfectly edible. We've all been eating it.
See?
And scum.
Nice little sugar rush.
Yeah. Nice. Little. Not little.
Okay. Now show us the letters that we've made here. You can roll this, and you can explain what we got here. Go ahead and roll this, guys.
First, print the name or words from your computer printer onto a sheet of tracing paper and make sure that it's no larger than about 1.5 inches high. Then take a handful of fondant and knead it so it's smooth and pliable, and just make sure it's smooth. then press and flatten it into a rectangular shape. And you could use the palm of your hand, you could use your fingers. Then take some powdered sugar and put it onto a cutting board and put the fondant down on it. And you could put some powdered sugar on top of the fondant and rub it across the surface. And then take your brayer or rolling pin and roll it out until it's about between an eighth and a quarter of an inch thick. Yeah, this is about what it should look like. And then take your tracing paper, put it on top of the fondant, and hold it down with two push pins. And then take a sharp X-Acto knife and start cutting out the letter, making sure you don't tear the fondant. And make sure you cut all around it. And when you feel secure, lift the tracing paper up, and there's your cutout letter. And as you can see here, what we've done is carefully removed the excess fondant away from the cutout letter. And then, it's ready to paint.
That's interesting. He's just mentioning that he doesn't work off a plan. It's all in his head. A lot of set designer
amazing
techniques, huh?
Yeah. A lot of things I do, in set design, I was taught to look at things and copy them and generally to think. I never had any cake decorating experience. I just... Right. Think.
And you make some great flavors, too. Describe
yes
what you...
Well, most of my cakes are frosted in chocolate. I just love chocolate. And I love raspberry fillings. I love heavy cream. Anything Julia Child like, I like. Beautiful.
Made out of the fondant.
Look, can we get a
shot of
that? Oh, that's beautiful.
Can we get a look?
You can also use the fondant like as...
Whoops, there we go.
As molds.
Isn't that cute?
As molds?
If you wanted like an imprint of my teeth.
Oh,
wait, look what he just did. You could use it as a mold.
In other words, my teeth are not that great, but you could you could do it on you could do it on a candy mold and get beautiful.
Okay.
Yeah, fondant is great.
That's great.
Show us this. Is it Donna Karen that you made a cake for?
Yes.
It was
at
Bloomingdale's. Whatever.
Beautiful. Nice.
Oh, my gosh.
That
wow
was about, that was complicated. Wow. That was about 4 feet wide and about 2.5 feet high, and it was about 10 tiers of cake that had to be engineered and fit together, linked together, because when we carried it, the buildings couldn't fall apart separately.
Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
But the whole thing was actually covered in white chocolate, and I use things in my place, nuts and bolts to get the windows. Anything
right
that's around, I use.
Wow.
You know, I try not to get too anal retentive of that stuff.
Well, you, like you said, you have the right attitude. At the end of all of this, he's going, look, it's cake, relax.
Look,
it's
what we
just
did here.
Cake.
These are little...
You did beautiful
little
ones before.
Oh, they're gorgeous.
Actually, you could finish the name if you take...
Go ahead.
Okay, what can we do?
If you take the F and the Y, finish the name so
family
we have...
Family here. It's not... I didn't know you did yours all in gold.
But you know what? It's cool.
Wow. Beautiful. Family.
It works.
There it goes.
Whatever works.
And here's an E.
Yeah, turn it around.
Turn it around.
It's right here.
The finest pastry chefs are... like Cliff, so well, self-taught.
Look,
I mean,
I like
beautiful
the E, so I'm just going to put the E there.
And neurotic. The neurotic, like, helps.
And neurotic, yes.
Tell me if I'm...
neurotic is good.
Tell me if I'm close at all. I made
what,
Woody.
What, you made me?
Oh, that's nice, Michael.
Yeah.
And look,
a good shot of that.
And look what Jose made. Look at this for his
heart
mom.
It's not bad.
Oh, look, can we get a shot of Jose over here?
That's me.
Guys? Over here, look at that.
Oh,
mom.
Look,
there you go.
Great.
Oh, sweet. Beautiful
right
stuff.
Well, you can get more information about Cliff's work. You can contact www.webart.com. Cake.
How
about that?
Or you can call 505-820-0231. I don't want to eat it, but I'm dying to taste
Cliff, you're
it.
You've
got to eat it.
Let's taste it.
We can't cut it.
We need a picture.
You've got to cut it. It is just...
Let him cut it.
Cake.
You do the honors.
Where's your camera?
You do the honors.
Okay.
Jamie,
here we go.
No, wait. We're going to take a picture first. Okay. Take a picture. Come on, Jamie. Come on.
Okay, everybody. I bought two, not just the cake.
Oh, come on.
Okay.
Got it? Okay.
You ready?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
Okay.
Yay.
Let's take one of the cakes. Okay. We're going to eat this, and we'll be back with the fashion guy, Lawrence Zarian, when we come back.
Beautiful.
Okay, another one?
The moment is here.
Yes.
We decided we'd wait and show this on the air, the big moment.
Would you care for some tea? A spot of tea. Here you go.
I'll have some eggs.
You want some eggs? Okay, all right. Some fruit,
some fruit.
All right, we need to cut the cake, so I will...
Oh, good save, though, wouldn't it?
I'm going to put this over here so we don't ruin it. This is a work of art.
Here we go.
All right, let's
cut it. Can we all cut it together?
Yeah,
sure.
Cut it together. Here we go.
Get a drum roll.
Say a prayer first.
I'm actually praying.
Slice.
All right.
cut a slice.
First slice.
No, I couldn't even.
All right.
And here it is.
Mikey?
Okay, here, put it on here.
Oh, look how beautiful.
Okay, and I got a bunch of,
He's gonna...
Just like when we get married.
Beautiful cake.
Wow.
Okay. Well, we cut another piece, and I'll give it to the other
guy. It tastes as good as it looks.
Cut one more piece.
Okay. Oops.
There.
Would you guys like some cake?
I don't know how you do that.
You know, he never asked for a second cup.
There you go.
Oh, this looks
okay, here, guys. Thank you.
Thanks, Gunnar.
Forget the segment.
You guys can eat.
Okay.
There you go.
All right. It's time now for a little fashion. Berkeley is rising. It's raining. It's Lawrence Zarian. It can only mean one thing. How to look cool and be hot at the same time. Latest summer fashions, Lawrence Zarian. Hi, Lawrence.
Hello.
That is so good.
This is such a good cake.
Hey,
Lawrence, what's the buzzword this summer?
Color. Color.
What?
Color.
Color?
Color. Evil. Color and retro-inspired fashions for the beach.
Right.
Thank you. And I must tell you, it's interesting. Carrie and her children love the fastness so much they wouldn't leave.
No, we're staying.
So they're staying. And she's been converted.
We don't leave, we're staying.
She was a shopper, and she has never been to Target to get clothes. So she
You've
was blown away.
You've never been to Target?
No.
Oh, my
goodness. Not for clothes.
All right.
So I have...
Well, what did you bring with you
today? I had to get rid of the chocolate. I have fashions from Target that are trend right and value priced.
Here we go.
Some great summer fashions. Let's start with our first couple. Let's start with Tracy and Tom.
Yeah.
And as you're going to notice, lime is going to be the sizzling statement this summer.
Yes.
Tracy's in a hot look from Exhilaration Separates.
Where's Kim Douglas when you need her? And
there
lime.
You go.
She
yeah.
needs a lime.
Probably at the tanning bed, maybe, getting some sun. Tracy's in a multicolored one-piece swimsuit with lycra for stretch and a lime and ocean blue slip dress cover-up, and the bathing suit is only $30. Tom's wearing fashions from Pro Spirit, color-blocking volley-style swim trunk and matching tank. Do you like that?
I know, wow.
It's sporty swimwear that's perfect for the season. Don't they look great?
They look great.
Fabulous.
So the color, lime and blue.
Very
real
nice.
Hot. Thank you very much. Let's bring out our next couple. Let's bring out Marin and Michael.
Yeah.
Marin and Michael are heating up the beach in active brights. Marin's making a huge splash in the hottest trends on the beach this season with her tropical mango and yellow tie-dyed halter and matching boy shorts by Target's private label, Exhilaration, and her 70s-inspired sarong. The 70s-inspired sarong pulls this sexy look together. And her guy Michael's in ready to take the plunge in these 100% nylon swim trunks from Pro Spirit. Isn't that a great look?
Yellow. Yeah. Very nice.
And Target has 807 stores across the United States.
Wow.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Christina, I think you're going to like this. Here we have Deborah and her son, Braxton. Their fashions are inspired by colors of the sea, saturated ocean blue and deep sea navy. In linen, which is the hot fabric this season, Deborah's wearing navy blue linen separates. And drawstring pants are a must-have this season for women. It's comfortable and it gives the look comfort knees. Her look is from Exhilarations. And her son Braxton compliments his stylish mom in fashions from Honors.
Look at that.
You having fun, Braxton?
Yeah.
Braxton,
yeah.
Would you like some cake? Yeah.
Braxton, you want some cake?
Look, you can use beautiful. Your shovel.
Yes.
Thank you very much,
very
Deborah.
Nice.
Thank you, Braxton.
Thank you, Deborah. Thank you, Braxton.
And now let's bring out our dad. Here we have Carl and his daughter, Carly.
Hi, Carly.
Carl's wearing a pair of iridescent blue swim trunks that are quality clothing from Utility. And his daughter, Carly, could give the Little Mermaid a run for her money.
Would you like some cake?
A little bit of cake.
No, thanks.
Okay.
She's wearing an adorable printed purple tee and matching multicolored biker shorts from Honor Kids.
How cute.
And Carly's entire outfit, $8.
$8?
Oh. $8.
Wow.
And its swimwear is active wear.
That is great.
Can you wave again, Carly, to the camera?
There you go.
There you go. Thanks, Carl.
Thanks, Carl. Thank you, Carly.
I must tell you, I was really surprised by these looks, some really great fashions, and there is no better way to end this segment than with a little nepotism. Let's bring out Teresa and my model of choice, Gregory!
Your brother!
Now, Teresa and Gregory are making, once again, a huge splash in versatile and comfortable active wear. Teresa's tie-dye tank and jean shorts are perfect for the beach or a weekend barbecue. Gregory's oversized baggy jeans from Utility and his Pro Spirit white tank are the perfect match for Teresa's sassy summer attitude. I must tell you, and these are just a few examples of styles from Target this summer that are sun-worthy of being caught.
Go stand next to your brother.
Can we get everybody out here again?
Yeah. Which one?
Excuse me.
This always kills me.
It's a beautiful job.
Always kills.
Why are you in the middle?
Well, because Teresa chose me.
She can stand over here with me.
Or you know what, Teresa? Do me. That is so unfair.
We want to get a hold of you right here. Mom. 1-800-800-8800. Put that number up, please, there for the good folks at Target and www.target.com if you'd like to get a hold of them on the web. Nice job, Laura. Yeah,
thank you.
Great fashion from Target. Go shopping.
Next, Marietta is going to show us how you can have your own indoor fountain when we come back.
Wait till it rains. You'll have one. Welcome back.
Look how beautiful this table is. We're at the pergola with the lovely Maita.
Who's going? I need to totally interrupt. Maita saw the great fashions, and she jumped on the linen bandwagon. Maita, you're wearing fashions from Target, from Ravona, and you
love it. I really love this.
And here we are.
And it fits in with this tropical look over here.
Isn't this beautiful? How easy is it to construct this 2-foot-high fountain from terracotta pots? Well, we are going to tell you because the lovely Maita has the answer to that.
I certainly do, but first I want to point out that not only can you make this lovely fountain, but you can make any kind of fountain you want with
really?
This simple technique. All you need are pots. You can even get colored pots, different kinds of pots, but we chose our strawberry pots because strawberry season is over, and what are you going to do with all those empty strawberry pots but make fountains
sure.
out
so.
Of them.
Bye, Lawrence.
So,
what shall do we
I?
Do? Please
yes.
continue.
Okay.
Yep.
I
what
tell
do we
you.
Need to make these, Maita?
You need clay pot sealer, a small pot that's about 12 inches tall, and that's going to be the base with a hole in the bottom,
mm-hmm.
a saucer, a large saucer, make sure that it's deep, at least 4 inches deep, and that's going to be the bottom, that's going to be the very base.
Thank you so much.
Then you need a little strawberry pot, a small one. Now you need a submersible pump, adjustable fountain head, 3 feet of half-inch vinyl tubing, and a flow regulator.
Aha.
And that's a lot
now
of gibberish, but
where?
You'll see what it means.
Could you get them like at Home Depot?
Home Depot, okay. We got everything at Home
there
Depot.
There you go.
And therefore, that means that this is very affordable.
Okay.
Anybody can do this.
I'm going to go home and make one for my mom.
Oh,
she'll,
you're the nicest
she'll really
son.
Like
go ahead and roll
it. Really, you will really surprise her by doing this.
Let's look at the tape, Maita.
Okay. First, you get that spray and you seal your pots, all of them, both inside and out.
With
because
what?
Clay. The sealer, the clay pot sealer.
All right.
And they're very porous and you want to stop them from leaking. And then you take your pump and you place it in the very center. Then you take your flow regulator and you stick it on the pump. Make sure that the flow regulator is on, open. Then you take your vinyl tubing and you stick that on your flow regulator. Then you start threading the pots through the vinyl tubing. This is, I mean, can you tell how easy this is? You stick it through the bottom, which has a hole already, and then you put it down on there, and now you're going to take your strawberry pot. Now notice the bottom one is upside down, but your strawberry pot is right side up.
Are they now, attached in any other way?
No other way, that's it. And now you take your adjustable fountain head and you stick that onto the vinyl tubing and you just secure it and twist it in so that it's nice and tight. And now it's done. Now all you have to do is fill it with water, fill the bottom with water, and turn the pump on.
Look at that.
And you have yourself a beautiful fountain. One tip though.
Yeah.
If you're going to have it outside, make sure that you always have water, that it never goes dry,
right.
And that your submersible pump is always underwater because right. You can ruin the motor.
It'll burn the
okay.
pump.
Now I noticed
it'll
you put little pebbles in here.
Yeah, that's
that looks
so
pretty.
That you yeah, it makes it prettier and you could use those marbles, colored marbles. Place little gardenias or flowers there, and you know, dress it up so
yeah.
that it's really, really
what kind
pretty.
Of plants so you don't that
yeah, I just
the
wanted to ask you, you have some indoor plants outside. Can these plants live outside okay, these indoor plants?
No, this is this can also go indoors. You can make this arrangement indoors,
but
and you could have this only if these are shade. So if you can provide it shade, then you can have these inside or outside in the summer. They're
how about
very
changing
tender.
The water on these?
On these?
About once a month or?
No, you just keep adding water.
Ah.
Just keep adding. Make sure that it doesn't run out of water. That's the most important thing.
Okay.
And these plants will love being around it because they'll catch whatever overflow there is, and they love the moisture of being around water. Ferns and begonias
and little cinerarias and caladiums. So you can have this beautiful arrangement in your home.
Very nice.
For not so much money.
Thank you.
And we got nature's waterfall going just as we speak. We'll take a break. It's volleyball time, but it's the type of volleyball you can play at night. Thanks to Night Spiker. I'll take a break. Be right back. Welcome back. Hey, everybody loves to play beach volleyball. The only problem is the sun goes down, game's over. Not anymore. A brand new invention called Night Spiker, which is designed to play volleyball at night. Please welcome John Harbert from Night Spiker Volleyball. Welcome, John.
Good to see you.
Hi. How you doing?
Pardon me, my hands are freezing.
Pleasure to be here.
Yeah. All right. So what is Night Spiker fluorescent volleyball all about?
Well, Night Spiker volleyball is volleyball played at night under black lights.
Ah, okay. From the 60s and 70s, right?
Yeah.
Those same black lights?
Yeah, same thing. So what we do here is we have 8 of these 7-foot-tall black lights that go around the court and illuminates the net, ball, and out-of-bounds line. So now, when the sun goes down, there's no need to stop playing.
Oh,
just play at night.
And you don't need any sunblock because the sun's gone.
No, how do you avoid hitting each other?
Well, that's sometimes that just always happens.
Like you run into each other and go...
Oh, well, what we do is we apply body paint.
No.
And all that glows. Everything cotton.
Oh, do we play naked?
Well, I've done setups.
Yeah.
It's possible. I've done them before.
Really?
Yes.
Let's take a look at the tape. We probably don't have that tape, but let's take a look at this tape.
How interesting is that?
Okay, this is one of the setups we've done at a bar. And we had about 50 people out there. We had a little tournament. And we painted everybody up. This is out on the beach. Now, it was totally dark. There was no lights there before. And there was no game at night. People went home. So what we did was had the black lights. And it was a big game going on.
Isn't that fun?
Oh, I love that idea. Wow. Yeah. Let's do it.
Walk us through what we need here, starting with the ball.
Okay, well, this right here, this Wilson AVP volleyball, this is what the pros use when they go around tour.
Right.
It's American Volleyball Professionals. It's one of the top-of-the-line volleyballs. And what we do is we paint it with a special paint, fluorescent paint.
Sure.
And that glows with the black lights.
That paint stays on. It doesn't chip off.
It stays on. Yeah. It matches
my jacket.
Yes, it does. It looks beautiful there, right next to it. It'll wear, you know, you use it so many times, and later on you'd have to apply some more paint.
I like it.
Headbands?
The headbands glow, fluoresce under the black lights. We put those on.
There you go.
Cool.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Cool.
And
very
then
nice.
You use the body paint?
Yeah, we have the body paint. Would you like to...
Come on, lay sweep you down.
So,
very nice.
And we also have some body paint here if we like to put some on.
Can I put some on your mic?
It's very simple.
Can I?
There you go. Just stick some on with your finger.
Okay. I promise I'll do a nice job, okay?
Okay.
All right. Look at mommy. All right. So you do this. All right. And then what?
Wait. Hano mo, Lena, Monoko.
That's good.
Very nice.
Okay.
Good.
Okay, look at me.
Half breed, that's all I ever was.
Okay. All right, just a second. One more time. Wait, okay.
Yeah, the more you put on, the better it's going to show.
Look at me.
Turn around.
Look at me.
The more you turn around.
No.
You're not an artist.
No, I am an artist.
No, you're not an artist. Okay.
No, wait.
At my expense.
No.
What kind of events have you staged besides making fun of hosts on television?
Oh, I've done all sorts of events. I ran a league out on the beach for a year.
Uh-huh.
I do a lot of corporate and private parties.
Uh-huh.
I do apartment complex parties, social events.
Sure.
I've done church events. I've done nudist camps.
Nudist camps?
And I followed the AVP tour around the state of Florida. I did 4 stops. I set up at the local bars around the tour.
Uh-huh.
And it was a big hit. A lot of the pros have seen it. And I'm trying to work with them, maybe doing something with the AVP and maybe a couple sponsors to do a nice Saturday night event.
Twister on my face. Look at that.
Wait a minute. In this way.
That's right.
There you go.
All right, now, you want to go in the room?
We've got a room set up.
Okay, let's go. Let's go in the room.
All right.
Come on.
Yeah, let's bring the balls with us.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
How fun is this?
Okay.
All right.
We have Gene Warren in here.
It's going to rain.
Wow, look at these guys. Cool. Go on, Mikey. Look at Mikey's face.
Look at that. Huh?
Mikey, you're too much.
There you go.
Look at that.
Look.
That is so cool. Maita. Woo! Isn't that great?
This would be great. I mean, playing at night, how fun would that be?
Heads up!
Well, no longer do you have to stop playing during the daytime. It can go right on to the night, early morning hours.
Look at Jose. He says, eat cheese, phone home, look at his finger.
This is great. All right, let's put up a number how to get in touch with you. This is a fun idea. Put up for parties. You name it. There it is. 1-888 GlowNet.
Now I know Night
Spiker.
Monroe's Bar Mitzvah.
This Thanks is such a much. Great idea.
All right, we'll take a break and give you a sneak peek of what's coming up on the Fox Family Channel. Walter Mellon. Take a break. Be right back. All right. Spike.
I love it. My kids will love this.
The Family Channel becomes the Fox Family Channel, and to introduce the new format, we're giving our home and family viewers a little sneak peek at the great programs coming up on the Fox Family Channel. Take a sneak peek at a great show called Walter Mellon. Walter Mellon is a cantaloupe of superheroes. You're with me on this? He's the cassava of cartoons. He's the honeydew of champions. You're with me on this? It's a very funny comedy spoof of the whole superhero thing. Show me again.
Here, Joe.
Take a look. Be right back.
Boy, is that like really?
Wow.
Oh, wow. Look at my teeth.
Roll
oh.
it.
Call Walter Mellon. Call Walter Mellon. Call Walter Mellon. Well, he's not hard to find. When your hero's sick and you must find a substitute, Walter Mellon is a choice.
At least he's got the suit.
Call Walter Mellon. Call Walter Mellon. Call Walter Mellon when you're down in a slump. Call Walter Mellon. Call Walter Mellon. Call Walter Mellon. He's the poser that's plump. If you're on a budget and you want replacement bricks, Walter Mellon needs the work.
So he wasn't your first pick.
Mellon, go, go, Walter Mellon. Go, Walter Mellon. Go, Walter Mellon. Go, Walter Mellon.
Funny cartoon, which is going to air daily on the Fox Family Channel. Let's see how Walter's doing now.
Busy. This so typical.
That was great. It's a cute show. Look for Walter Mellon now starting August 15th on the Fox Family Channel.
Right, and we'll be right back.
We'll be right back. Tuned in to Home and Family. It's obvious you've missed another day of what goes on here at Home and Family. We have just a few minutes here to wrap up a couple more pieces of email. This one comes to you from a little 12-year-old. Gloria says, I want to know what kind of shampoo you are using because it works great. Your hair is so shiny and bouncy. Oh. I love the show. I'd like to find out what you do. She said, I'm homeschooled. My mom lets me watch the show if I get my work done by 1 o'clock. This is a 12-year-old Gloria. What kind of shampoo do you use?
You know, I use White Rain. The coconut, it comes, yes, it comes in coconut, which I love, and all different kinds of great
all the time?
Smells. Yeah.
Well, I switch some,
because I believe you should switch your shampoos every once in a while. So I use the White Rain rain conditioner and the shampoo, but then I switch over to this other shampoo, just whatever.
Store brands,
you know, but the main one I use is the White Rain.
There
and
you
I
go.
Love the. I always feel like I'm having a pina colada in my head.
You don't have to switch. There's Neutrogena has a shampoo that takes off all the products so that you can keep using your own shampoo. I do that once
I love
a week.
That. Like every like fifth or sixth shampoo, I use another shampoo and another conditioner.
I use Ultra Turpentine once a month and it takes it right off.
And it takes your hair out, too.
What else do we have? Maida, do you have one? Or Jamie? This lorazepam is going right into my brain, I think is what it is.
We always. Thank you. We always get great kitchen emails, and we have a question from New Jersey. There's no name on it, but she says, I use cream cheese all the time, and I wonder if you have a great tip at how to soften it. Oh. I know a lot of people put cream cheese in the microwave. If you go too long in the microwave, the cream cheese does begin to break down. And I think the greatest tip is, and we actually got this as a kitchen tip for butter when you're making cakes, to warm the bowl that you're going to use first with a mixer, rinse it in hot water from the sink, then dry it out, and then place the cream cheese in the bowl. And what it does is it softens the cream cheese just enough without breaking it down or changing the texture.
You just warm the bowl, you say, with hot water?
That's right. Rinse it in hot water in the sink and then wipe it out. And then you have sort of softened cream cheese but not yet melted.
Or leave it at room temperature for an hour.
Exactly. That's a good rush situation.
Yeah, rush.
Yep.
Okay.
And then we have another one for asparagus, too. No time? Okay.
No.
We'll get to it later.
Okay. Well, that's your cliffhanger, then.
Thank
you. What are they going to do with the asparagus?
Do you like that?
I love what are they going to do
Tune in tomorrow for all the families.
Jose Solano from Baywatch. Thanks for all the dance lessons.
Yeah.
What's the movie you're up for?
Dirty Dancing.
Dirty Dancing 2. We'll look for you on that. Hope you get it.
Absolutely.
All right, Maida, Gang Barnes, everybody.
And Night Spiker,
Night
John Harper.
Thank you. Play a little volleyball at night. John Harper.
Great team, Harper.
See you next time. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Beautiful flowers for special occasions and special people. Call Global Florist, toll free, 888-400-ROSE. Mention Home and Family for $5 off your order.
Production facilities provided by Universal Studios Hollywood.